Today's session is on pricing decision. So I think this pricing decision is the most important one because all the market forms depends on this. As we know, it is a managerial economics, and from the point of view of the manager, it is the most important point, as the manager always want to satisfy his profit maximization goal, and this profit maximization goal is depends on the price. Why on price? Because after finalizing that what output or what amount of product is to be produced, then the next question for the manager is at what price it is to be sold in the market. So here two things come, that price and market. So today's session is basically on these two important terms or two important concepts, that what are the different market forms, such as perfect competition, pure competition, monopoly, monopolistic competition, etc., and how these forms of market are distinguished from each other. Means, what is the basis of classification of these different forms of markets, and how the pricing strategies or pricing decisions are to be taken under these different market forms, on the basis of which the manager's profit maximization goal will be satisfied. So without any delay or without wasting any time, I welcome our resource person, Dr. Ashish Das. He is from Odisha State Open University, from the Department of Economics. So good morning, sir.
Good morning.
So I request you to please start the session.
Thank you. Thank you for the introductions, Sunita ma'am. I'll be sharing this PowerPoint presentation. Amit,
yes, sir.
How do I share the screen?
Sir, upon the screen,
click on the screen.
ସେ ଛୋଟ ସ୍କ୍ରିନକୁ ଆପଣ କ୍ଲିକ୍ କରନ୍ତୁ, ତାପରେ ସେୟାର ଅପସନକୁ ସେୟାର କରନ୍ତୁ। ୟେସ୍ ସାର୍, ଏବେ ଆପଣଙ୍କ ସ୍କ୍ରିନ ଆମେ ଦେଖିପାରୁଛୁ। ଏବେ ଆପଣ ୟେସ୍ ସାର୍, ଆପଣ ଏବେ ଆପଣ ପିପିଡିକୁ କ୍ଲିକ୍ କରନ୍ତୁ, ପିପିଡି ଆମେ ଦେଖିପାରିବା।
ପିପିଡି କେ ମତେ ତ ଦେଖାଯାଉ ନାହିଁ।
ନାଇଁ ନାଇଁ, ଆପଣ ଦେଖିପାରିବେ ନା ଆପ
ଏବେ ସାର୍ ଆପଣଙ୍କ ପିପିଡି ପ୍ରେଜେଣ୍ଟେସନ କୁ କ୍ଲିକ୍ କରନ୍ତୁ।
ଆଚ୍ଛା, ଅବିକା, ଆର ୟୁ ଏବଲ ଟୁ ଭିୟୁ ନାଓ? मार्केट स्ट्रक्चर नाउ बिफोर एंटरिंग टू द मार्केट स्ट्रक्चर आई वुड लाइक टू हैव सम डिस्कशंस ऑन द बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट्स। That one is the market. Market is nothing but the point of contact between the buyers and seller. It consists of those firms from which a buyer can buy goods and or services. It consists of those buyers to whom it can sell goods or services. Now, at this point, it is essential to have some knowledge about farm and industry. A farm is something which basically arranges the factors of production and converts into certain goods and services which is suitable for consumption to sell it in the market, presumably at some kind of profit. Now, when we are talking about industry, it is basically a collection of firms in a market for a particular commodity or service. Now, when we are talking about a market structure, the type of market in which the firm operates is basically known as the market structure. The type of market means it could be a perfectly competitive market, it could be a monopoly market, it could be oligopoly, oligopsony, monopolistic, monopsony. There are different types of market structure and then in which the firms generally operates. Now, in the context of production function, you would have already come across the term short run and long run. Now, in the production function, what we have studied, short run is a time period where fixed factor cannot vary. And long run is a period where all the factors are variable. But in the context of market, the short run means it refers to the period over which number of firm is fixed. That means we cannot alter the firm size or the number of firms. There cannot be any entry or exit into the industry in the short run. But when we are talking about long run, it is possible for the firms to enter or exit from the industry. Now, we move on to the next, that is market structure, which is perfectly competitive market, and we'll be also covering as per syllabus the monopoly, monopolistic, and the oligopoly market structure. Now, coming to the perfect competition, what is the difference between a perfect competition and a pure competition? Look at perfect competition. It has several features like the large number of buyers and sellers. When we are talking about large number of buyers and sellers, what does it mean? What is that number? Actually, when we are talking about large number of buyers and sellers, it means no individual buyers or sellers can basically influence the market outcome such as price or quantity. The buyers cannot influence the price by purchasing more or less. Similarly, the sellers cannot alter the market price by each own individual standalone behavior. Similarly, there is something called product homogeneity. When product is homogeneous, that means there is no reason why one product is preferred over others. They are identical in all aspects. That means you are not in a position to, or there is no reason for choosing a product over another. They are same in size, quality, color, shape, everything. So they are homogeneous product. Now, when we are talking about perfect competition, we also come across free entry and exit of the firms. The firms are free to enter into the industry and exit from the industry as per their wishes. So there is no entry barrier for the firm, or there is nothing that stops them to exit from the industry. Now, profit maximization. The firms generally may have different types of goal, but under perfect competition, it is assumed that the firm has only single goal, that is maximizing the profit. And also, there is no government intervention. So, if all these high characteristics, is it audible? Am I audible?
Yes, please continue.
So if all these five characteristics are satisfied, then
sir, please press 5, sir. F5 press, sir.
So If all these characteristics are satisfied, then we are into perfect competition. You are in a pure competition. Now, for perfect competitions, we have some additional characteristics, like the perfect mobility of factors of production and perfect knowledge. What is perfect mobility? The laborers are fully mobile between different jobs, different locations. Then there is perfect mobility of factors of production. Similarly, other factors are also fully mobile from one industry to another industry, such as capital, etc. And there is perfect knowledge. The perfect knowledge in terms of all the market conditions, information is free and priceless. If these two conditions are additionally satisfied along with earlier condition that I have mentioned for a pure competition, then we will call it as a perfect competition. Now, the meaning of competition is known to us. Competition generally understood is a fact where there are some element to compete. For example, you have the flexibility of changing the price or varying the quality of the product, or marketing strategy may be adopted through advertisement, etc. But under perfect competitions, given the assumption, there is no such thing. The price is given, the product is homogeneous, so there is hardly any scope for competitions in the sense we understand the term competition. But there is still some element of competitions in perfect competition, that is, if you are not able to produce at the market determined price and sell profitably, then you are out of the competition, so you will no longer be there in the industry. That is what each competition is in the context of the perfectly competitive market. Now, outcome of a perfectly competitive market are as follows. The actions of any single buyer or sellers in the market have no impact or a very negligible impact on the market price. So any individual buyers and sellers cannot influence the market price. Similarly, each buyers and sellers takes the market price as given. So it is given to them, it is industry determined. Then buyers and sellers in the competitive markets are price taker, because price is given to them and it is decided in the industry. They are not price maker. They have to accept whatever price that is decided in the industry. Buyers and sellers most accept the price determined by the market. Now, let us see the concept of total, average and marginal revenue. Since under perfect competition, price is fixed, you can see here the price is 6 everywhere and there are different quantity of output. Now, when we are looking at the total revenue is nothing but the multiplication of price into quantity. So we multiply, we get 1 into 6 as 6, 6 into 2 as 12, 6 into 3 as 18, 6 into 4 as 24. Like that, this column is derived. So this is the total revenue, which is basically price into quantity, number of units sold multiplied by price per unit. And the average revenue is nothing but the total revenue divided by quantity. Now you can see here, average revenue here is basically equal to the price of the product in each of these cases, irrespective of the quantity. Similarly, marginal revenue, which is the addition to the total revenue for one additional unit being produced. The marginal revenue is defined as the addition to the total revenue when one extra unit is produced. So when the producer is producing one additional unit, that is unit 1 to 2, his total revenue is changing from 6 to 12. So the marginal revenue is 12 minus 6 as 6 here. Similarly here, when 2 to 3 unit is being produced, then 18 minus 12 is 6. Similarly, in each of the cases, the marginal revenue is also 6. This is basically in the context of a competitive firm or perfectly competitive market structure. Now, if you look at a numerical example, you will see the marginal revenue and the marginal cost here. I have inserted cost in the earlier example here. Now, suppose the cost increases. This is, you can see, when there is quantity is zero, the cost here is 3. What does that mean? What is this cost basically? This is basically the fixed cost. Now, fixed cost is something which occurs even without production or when the production is zero. You have to incur certain fixed cost. So when you increase the production from 0 to 1 unit, the fixed cost has to be added with some variable cost. So the total cost becomes 5 here for production of 1 unit. That means the difference is 2 rupees is the variable cost, or 5 minus 3, which is the addition to the total cost because of one additional unit being produced, is the marginal cost, which is 2 here again. So when we are moving from 0 unit to 1 unit, we are incurring total cost as 5, the variable cost as 2, and the marginal cost as 2 again. Similarly, when we produce second unit under perfectly competitive market, second unit, the addition to the total cost is again 3. That means your marginal cost is 3 and total cost changes to 8, and we are having the marginal cost as 3 and total cost as 8. Similarly, these tables are computed. Is this clear? So, profit maximization of a competitive farm. Now, when we are looking at competitive farm, the total revenue, total cost curve is downward falling, and then average cost curve will be below the total cost curve, which is already discussed in the cost concept. Now, we know that under perfect competition, price is given. Price is given and it is horizontal because it is market determined. You have seen in the earlier example, our price was 6 rupees, which is market, which was determined in the market. So here we can see the price equal to average revenue equal to marginal revenue. As you have seen in earlier diagram, here you can see the price equal to marginal revenue equal to the price equal to marginal revenue equal to the average revenue. All three were 666 here. So we have P equal to AR equal to MR. Now MC or marginal cost curve is upward sloping, and it costs the average cost curve from below for the determination of output, equilibrium output. Now here we can see the MC costs the marginal cost at this point, and therefore the maximum quantity that can be produced is Q max here. At this price, we can see the farm maximizes the profit by producing the quantity at which marginal cost MC, which is equal to the marginal revenue. At this point, marginal cost is equal to marginal revenue, and MC costs MR from below. Suppose MC is coming from this side and cutting somewhere here as C cost, then it is not. MC must be rising at the point of equilibrium. So this point is the profit maximizing output of the farm. Now at this point, you can see MC equal to Q1. And at this point, MC equal to, so if the price falls to this level, the farm will produce Q1 output. If the price increases to this level, MC2, then farm will produce Q2 level of output. So you can see that the farm is basically producing at some point of or other where the price is intersecting the marginal cost. So this marginal cost curve is nothing but the supply curve. Of course, the marginal cost curve that lies above the minimum point of average variable cost, which is also known as the shutdown point, which you will see later. That means that part of the marginal cost curve which is lying above this minimum point of the average variable cost curve is known as the supply curve of the farm. So profit maximization under competitive farm occurs at quantity where MC equal to MR, and where MC cost MR from below. So profit maximization for the competitive farm has three things. When MR is greater than MC, which is increasing, you have to increase the quantity. Whenever MR is less than MC, we have to decrease the quantity. And when MR equal to MC and MC costs MR from below, it is the profit maximizing level of output of the farm. So here you can see again, if this is the price, this is the quantity, because the price is equal to MC, or MC price is equal to MR. So MR and MC are intersect at that point. So there is, this is Q1. If the price is this, quantity produced would be Q2. Similar, therefore, the sections of the farms MC curve is also the farm supply curve. The MC curve that is lying above the minimum point of the average variable cost curve is the supply curve of the farm under profit competition. So farms short-run decision to shut down. At this point, is there any questions? Is there any questions? Am I clear? So shall I move on to the short run decisions of shutdown? Shutdown refers to a short run decision of not producing anything during a specific period of time because of current market condition. So if for some reason or other the farms takes a decision not to produce anything during the short run, then we can call it as the shutdown. Call it a shutdown. So it is a temporary short run decision. So, but it is different from exit, which refers to the long run decision to leave the market. When the farm exit, he is no longer there in the market, he is leaving the market. Shutdown means it's only the production is closed, but the farm is still there in the industry. The farm's short-run decision to shut down, the farm's, while taking this short-run decisions, it considered, the farm considered its sunk cost when deciding to exit, but it ignores when deciding whether to shut down. What is this sunk cost? Sunk costs are the costs that have already been committed and cannot be recovered. That means if a telecom company, for example, a telecom company wants to operate, he has to take a license. Now they have to pay some license fee to Department of Telecommunication, which is not recoverable. Once you take a decision, you have to pay some license fee and then obtain the permission. Now, suppose you want to exit from the industry, then the license fee is non-refundable. So it's some cost. So in your future decision of how much to produce, you don't take into account the sunk cost. Now the farms shutdowns, if the revenue it gets from producing is less than the variable cost of production. So the farms shutdowns if the revenue it gets from producing is less than the variable cost of production. So when the price falls below average variable cost, the revenue below the variable cost, then the farm shutdowns. That means shutdown if total revenue is below the variable cost, or if the average revenue, that is TR by Q, is below average cost, that is variable, average variable cost, that is variable cost by Q, or if price is below average variable cost, the farm will shut down, because it will give more loss to the farm. You can see it in this diagram. This is the point I was talking about. If C is below ABC, the farm has to shut down. If P is greater than ABC, keep producing in the short run. If P is greater than average total cost, keep producing at a profit. So if the price is above this point, the average total cost, then you can go on producing at a profit. And funds short run, this is why this is also the funds short run supply curve. Now,
hello, sir.
Yes.
सर से प्रेजेंट जो के लंदन फ्यूचर स्क्रीन ट्रांसफर थे दैट्स व्हाई इस प्रेजेंटेशन हमें देखि पर नो स्लो बड़ स्क्रीन रे फाइनली आउट रिज्यूम करन तो अपन आउट हो से रिज्यूम लिखाई थो अपन आउट हो जान तो
ये रिज्यूम
हां अपन गूगल से गूगल मीट स्क्रीन को जान सो अबे अपन पीपीटी खोल चंदे सिस्को
बुक खोल दो जी ऑथर रोल बटन में कितने बड़ो देखि पर ना
एबे सर
स्टॉप
शेयरिंग करी कि आउट सोर नले हां से क्लिक करन तो हां देखो न टळे रिज्यूम लिखाई थो रिज्यूम पीपीटी बॉटम बॉटम वहां पर
राव थरे मु शेयर कर दो
यस सर लर्नर्स प्लीज नीचे स्क्रीन को अपन शेयर करन तो नहीं अदरवाइज हमें पीपीटी डिस्प्ले होबो नहीं हां ओ फोटो
मिनट जस्ट कीप मी प्रेजेंट नाउ प्रेजेंट विंडो
विंडो ने सेंटर
हेलो बेटा हबो बेटा हेलो आसिला
नो सर यबे हां यस सर सर चैट बॉक्स रिलेटेड टू डायग्राम
इज द स्क्रीन विजिबल नाउ
सर डायग्राम एंड आल्सो अबाउट द टेबल
व्हाट इज दैट
प्रॉफिट मैक्सिमाइजेशन लास्ट टेबल ऑफ प्रॉफिट मैक्सिमाइजेशन ऑफ कॉम्पिटिटिव मार्केट
प्लीज ओके वन मिनट डायग्राम इज नॉट ओके if you don't in response to the okay diagram is not under which diagram profit maximization diagram is it
yes,
visible
sir.
now
yeah.
This diagram. So I have not come to profit maximization, I believe, so far. Is this the diagram talking about?
This diagram, sir. This diagram.
This one.
Yes, sir. This one.
Yes. Okay. No. See, for any firm there is a cost. This total cost, which is combination of your average cost and the variable cost. Now, when you divide that total cost with Q, you will get the average cost, and with different unit, you will have different average cost. Accordingly, the average total cost curve is drawn here. You can see in the previous table the average total cost here. Each we can here the total cost is there. When we divide it with quantity, 5 by 1, 8 by 2, 12 by 3, you will get an average total cost. Correct. So that one can be plotted in graph to get the average total cost. Similarly, variable cost. If the total variable cost is divided with quantity, at different quantity will have different variable cost, which is plotted here. Now we know that in a perfectly competitive market, the price is industry determined. That means all the farms will produce their output, they will go to the market, and all the buyers will do the purchasing there. So the combined demand and supply force will determine and then give a price. That price is determined in the industry, which is given for all the farms, all the buyers. Now take, let's see, this is the price. Now in this, if you superimpose, this price is given by the industry to the farm and the buyers in under profit competition. Now here, if we superimpose the marginal cost, the marginal cost is intersecting the marginal revenue at this point, and corresponding to that point, the maximum Q is decided. Now you look at something. If you go above this, what is happening? The additional cost that we are incurring to produce the output is greater than the revenue that or price that we are receiving. Any point above this point, each the cost, additional cost is more, and then the price is less because price is given. So no farm will produce beyond this point. But below this point, if you produce more, you will get additional revenue. Is this clear? Is this clear? The farm maximizes profit by producing the quantity at which marginal cost is equal to marginal revenue and MC costs MR from below. So this is the profit maximizing, or this is the output, that maximum output that the farm can should produce. If he is producing below that, he will incur loss. We'll see it again also little later. And then if he is producing above that, it is also, it is not getting any benefit. It cost is more in comparison to the revenue. Now, given the price, he can take the decision. Suppose the price is here. Instead of P, the price is MC2, for example. In that case, what is going to happen? The farms will be selling more quantity and he will be earning more revenue because his cost structure is same. But if the price is MC1, in this case, he will still produce, but he will be incurring losses because his total cost is above the total cost is here for this unit, Q1 unit, his total cost is here and the price is here. So he will be incurring some loss, but still it is beneficial for him to produce at this point because he is minimizing the loss at this point. So profit maximization occurs at quantity where MC equal to MR and MC costs MR from below. This we have discussed. Suppose price is this. The price is this. The quantity would at price P1, quantity would be Q1. At price P2, quantity that would be produced is Q2. So this is the part of the MC that lies above the minimum point of ABC would be the supply curve of the farm. Farms sort out decisions, but the sort down, I have already discussed it, and what is the difference between shutdown and the exit. Shutdown is a short run phenomena, while exit is a long run phenomena. Shutdown case is stopping production temporarily, and in the exit case he is quitting the business altogether. The farm is considering sunk cost only when it is exiting from the farm, and sunk cost is not taken into account for temporary shutdown of the farm. Farm shutdowns, if revenue gets from producing is less than the variable cost of production, or shutdown if total revenue is below variable cost, or price is below average variable cost. Now you can see here, if this is the shutdown point where P is less than ABC. If P is greater than ABC, keep producing in the short run. If P is greater than average total cost curve, or price is greater than average total cost curve, it will keep producing at a profit. Now, we have also discussed about farm staying business with zero accounting profit. That is, profit equals to total revenue minus the total cost. The total cost includes all the opportunity cost of the farms. In the zero profit equilibrium, the farm's revenue compensates the owner for the time or money they spend to keep the business going. So this is nothing but the opportunity cost. Now, an accountant would not consider this opportunity cost while computing the total cost, but an economist take into account the cost. For example, if you are putting the capital, if you would not have put the capital or money into your business, you would have put it somewhere else, maybe in a fixed deposit, and you would have earned some interest. That is the opportunity cost. That is the next best alternative the factor of production should have earned. Suppose you as an entrepreneur would not have worked in the industry, you would have worked somewhere else, and then you would have got some kind of salary. So that is your opportunity cost. So each factor of production, suppose you have a land that or your own house is being used for the business purpose. Suppose you would not have used for your own business, you would have rented it out and you would have earned some rent. That is the opportunity cost of the building that you are using for the business purpose. So the opportunity cost is added to the total cost when an economist computes the cost of production. So impact of increase in demand in the short run. So what happens? An increase in demand raises the price and quantity in the short period. Farm earns profit because price now exceeds the average total cost. What happens is, here we can see the initial condition of equilibrium is here. Because in the long run, the market price is given and all the farms are earning normal profit initial condition. Now suppose for some reason or other, there is an increase in the price. If the price increases, what is going to happen? Because this increase happens because of the shift in the demand. Demand shifts upward, therefore the price has increased. Now we can see that the price has increased from P1 to P2. This is the industry price. Again, this is given for all the farms. As a result of that, what is going to happen? There will be a profit for the farm. Because his price has increased, cost is there. So he is able to produce. You can see here that earlier, this was the equilibrium point, P1 output was being produced. But because of the price increase, he is now producing at this point. So the price, because of the increase in price, more output, that is Q1, Q2, additional output is being produced, Q1, Q2. So because of that, there is this range would be considered as the profit for the farm. Now, this profit will induce other farms to enter into the market, because when they see profits, because of the condition of free entry and free exit, other farms will start entering, and with the entry of the farm, slowly more number of farms will join the industry and this profit will wither away. Short run, supply in the competitive market. Market supply equals the sum of the quantities supplied by the individual farms in the market. The way the market demand is the summation of all the individual buyers' demand, similarly, the market supply also equals the sum of the quantities supplied by individual farms. All the farms MC curve, literally, if you add, then you will get the market supply curve. Now, the market supply curve with a fixed number of farms. For any given price, each farm supplies a quantity of output so that its marginal cost is equal to price that we have seen. The market supply curve reflects the individual farm's marginal cost curve. That also we have seen. This is the market MC curve of the, suppose there are identical farms, then fixed number of farms, then if one farm's MC is this, then if you have thousand of farms, the supply curve would be 10,000, because this is 10 times. Because if you have thousand of identical farm, 1,000 identical farms, the supply curve would be 10,000. So we have just added all the markets, individual farms, and then arrive at the market supply curve here. So long run market supply curve, there will be entry and exit. So what happens in the long run market supply, there will be entry and exit. Farms will enter or exit the market until profit is driven to zero. So in the long run, price equals to minimum of average total cost. Supply curve is horizontal at that price. So in the long run, we will have this kind of a situation where all the farms are earning only normal profit. There is no super normal or extra normal profit which is earned. If there is extra normal profit, there will be new farms which will be entering into the market, and they will take away the profit, and each farms will earn again the normal profit. At the end of the process of entry and exit, the farms remains must be making zero economic profit. There is no economic profit. There will be accounting profit. However, there will not be any economic profit. The process ends only when the price and average total cost are driven to equality. So long run equilibrium must have, in long run equilibrium, must have farms operating at their efficient scale. Farms stay in business with zero profit. Profit equals to total revenue minus total cost. Total cost includes all the opportunity cost of the farms. And in the zero profit equilibrium, farms revenue compensates the owner for the time and money they spend to keep the business going. This is nothing but the opportunity cost concept that we are discussing. Increase in demand in the short run. An increase in demand raises price and quantity in the short run. Farms earns profits because price now exceeds the average total cost. And as a result, we have seen that there is profit. Now, long run supply curve might slope upward. There are, in the earlier case, we have seen this long run supply curve is horizontal. However, there could be cases where long run supply curve could be either upward sloping or downward sloping. This is because the industry condition. It can be the industry in the sector market could be either increasing cost or decreasing cost industry. Some resources used in the production may be available only in limited quantity, and that may raise the price, and therefore the supply curve of the farm could be either upward sloping. The farm may have different cost. Note, because a competitive farm is a price taker, its revenue is potential to is proportional to the amount of output it is producing. Because the farm is a price taker, whatever price is given, we are just multiplying it with the quantity produced. So its revenue has to be proportional to the output it is producing. And the price of the goods equals both the farm's average revenue and its marginal revenue. So price equal to AR equal to MR in the case of perfect competition. Now we shall switch over to monopoly. At this stage, if there is any doubt, is it visible? Any doubt? Okay. Now we shall switch over to, yes, sir. What is this doubt? Why curve slopes downward? So the last table, why? first floor downward. Number 10, more counter, entrance. Okay. Which table? Okay, this is fine. So fit maximization. Now show the last table by first floors. Which car? Which car? 1 minute. Which car? Which car? Supply curve is not okay. No, I don't have any picture where the supply curve is sloping downward. Actually, this is one I have given where the supply curve is horizontal. And the other one I am talking about, the supply curve is upward sloping in the long run. Okay. Similarly, there could be a case which is rare. If the cost industry is decreasing cost industry, you may have a situation where the supply curve could also be downward sloping, which is rare. Okay. The supply curve generally slopes upward and the demand curve is downward sloping and the intersection point is giving you the equilibrium price. Now, when there is a shift in the demand is shifting, you will get into another equilibrium, another market price, because the interaction between demand and supply gives you the equilibrium price. This price is now P2. This is again given or determined by the industry. So this is the equilibrium price. Now at this point, what would be the equilibrium quantity? It would be Q2 H. Here also we can see from Q1 to Q2. Now, because the more quantity is sold at a higher price, the total cost curve is remaining constant, which is not changing because there is no change in the cost condition. Okay. You get profit. This is what is your economy, this profit or super normal profit or extra normal profit in terms of economics. Is this clear? It is clear now? Okay. For long run, what happens? All the firms will earn only normal profit in the long run because of the entry and exit condition. In the long run, what happens? In the short run, this is possible. Firms can earn super normal profit. But in the long run, what happens? You are having enough time for entry and exit. So the firms, if they reach losses for some firm, they will exit from the industry in the long run. If there are some firms which are earning super normal profit, new firm will enter into the industry and they will take away the profit. So in the long run, all the firms will earn only normal profit. There will not be either losses or super normal profit for any firm in the industry. Now, sir, we shall switch over to monopoly. Now, what is monopoly? Shall we switch over to monopoly? Monopoly is basically a firm where there is only single seller. Monopoly, firm is considered a monopoly if there is only a sole seller for its product. this product does not have any close substitute. So if there is close substitute, what will happen? Your monopoly power will be very less. So there should not be any close substitute, and there should be only a single product in the market, a single seller in the market. So while a competitive firm is a price taker, a monopoly firm is a price maker, because it can decide what price to sell the goods and services. Why monopoly arises? Monopoly may arises because of several reasons. The fundamental cause of monopoly is barrier to entry. So if you have listened to the webinar yesterday, the regulator permits. So there will be either regulatory barriers, or there could be some other government barriers. For example, defense equipment, government may not allow anyone else to produce. So there will be entry barrier. Monopoly, for example, in railway, you cannot start a train service from one place to another because it is not allowed. Maybe there are other reasons, but it is not permissible by the government. So there is barriers to entry. So barriers to entry have three sources, basically. The ownership of a key resource. Suppose you are owner of certain resources, then it will, which is not there, which is available only to you exclusively and not there with anyone else, then you can become a monopolist. Similarly, the government gives a single firm the exclusive right to produce some goods in the case of defense equipment, or for example, this railway. Railway services is only given by it is by the government itself. So government is giving exclusive right to produce some goods to only one firm. Then the cost of production make a single producer more efficient than large number of producer producing the same goods. This is the case of a natural monopoly. That means in this case, as and when you go on producing more and more output, your average cost tends to fall because of economies of scale. So these are the causes that may lead to monopoly. So monopoly of resources means, although exclusive ownership of a key resource is a potential source of monopoly, in practice, monopoly rarely arises because of this reason. So you will not have any practical example where one person has got only exclusive ownership of some product, some raw materials to produce certain goods and services. Similarly, government created monopoly. Government may restrict entry by giving a single firm the exclusive right to sell a particular goods in a certain market. So this is the government created monopoly or government monopoly. Similarly, we have patent and copyright laws are two important examples of how government creates a monopoly to serve the public interest. So patent and copyright laws are another source of for example, now because of this COVID, people are after producing a vaccination. The firm which produces fast is likely to have a patent on it. Now, because of that patent, it will get a monopoly power over of selling that particular vaccination over a period of time, which others cannot do, or they have to pay certain royalty to the R&D department or the company who has the patent for that product. So they are all trying to produce fast. So patent is one source of monopoly. Similarly, the copyright laws. Natural monopoly. An industry is a natural monopoly when single firm can supply a goods or service to the entire market at a smaller cost than two or more firms. That means an industry is a natural monopolist when a single firm, it is feasible for a single firm to supply the goods and service to the entire market at a lesser cost than what two firms or more firms can do. If two or more firms are producing the same goods, the average cost would be more for each one of them, and the price at which they will be selling would be higher. So in the case of natural monopoly, there is only one firm producing the product. Natural monopoly arises when there are economies of scale over relevant range of the average output. That means this is the kind of a case where again when your quantity of output is increasing, your average cost is falling. So the same firm, when it is increasing the output, its average cost keeps on falling. So he would be in a better position to supply the goods to the market. Second firm entry would result in higher price. A monopolist revenue. We have seen the market competitions. Now you observe what is happening to the monopolist. Monopolist revenue is also nothing but P into Q, but its average revenue again is total revenue by Q, and marginal revenue is change in total revenue as a result of change in quantity. Now, in the case of pocket competition, price used to be constant, but here in monopoly, the price varies. So if you have, it is not given by the industry, because the monopoly firm itself is the industry, it has the power to change the price. Now, if you look at the price 11, the quantity, the total revenue, total quantity is zero, therefore revenue would be zero. At price 10, one quantity is purchased, so total revenue is P into Q, that is 10. At price 9, 2 quantity, that is 18. At price 8, 3 quantities are purchased, so 24. Like that, this table price into quantity has been computed, total revenue. Average revenue is nothing but total revenue by Q, that means 10 divided by 1, 10, 18 divided by 2 as 9, 24 divided by 3 as 8, 28 divided by 4 is 7, 30 divided by 5 equal to 6, 30 divided by 6 equal to 5, like that average revenue is computed. And marginal revenue is the addition to the total revenue for one additional unit being produced. That means when we are producing 1 to 2, our total revenue is changing from 10 to 18. So the difference between 18 and 10 is our marginal revenue here. Here, 0 to 1, when we are increasing our output, the total revenue is increasing from 0 to 10. So 10 minus 0 is 10 is our marginal revenue. Similarly here, 24 minus 18 is 6 is our marginal revenue. Accordingly, this marginal revenue is calculated. So a monopolist, marginal revenue is always less than the price of its goods. The marginal revenue you can see here is less than the price of the goods. Here it is 9, here it is 8, here it is 8, it is 6 here. So marginal revenue is always below the price of the goods. It cannot exceed the price. The demand curve for the monopolist is downward sloping. The demand curve in the case of pocket competition was horizontal straight line, that was the AR curve. But in the case of monopoly, the demand curve is downward sloping. The monopolist marginal revenue is when a monopoly increases the amount it sells, it has two effects. What is happening? When a monopoly increases the amount it sells, there will be the total revenue, it has got P and Q. Output, that more output is sold, so Q is higher. When a monopoly increases the amount it sells, the Q is increased, so more output. But the price effect, price falls, you can increase the output selling only by reducing the price. So your price is falling and the quantity is increasing. Therefore, what happens? You have a downward sloping average revenue curve and the marginal revenue curve. What is happening here is you have a demand curve, which is average revenue curve, and you have a monopoly, this marginal revenue curve, marginal cost curve is intersecting the marginal revenue curve from below, and therefore the maximum quantity. This is the condition of equilibrium, MR equal to MC, and it is extending this up to AR, and then it charging the monopoly price here. So this is your monopoly price. The intersections of the marginal revenue curve and the marginal cost curve determines the profit maximizing output or quantity. The intersections of marginal revenue and this marginal revenue curve and marginal cost curve is determining the output, and the firm extends this up to average revenue curve, this line up to average revenue curve, to decide the monopoly price. A second thing that is to be noted here, that then the demand curve shows the price consistent with the quantity. This is the demand curve, or average revenue curve is the demand curve. So here we can see the corresponding price. Now here what happens? For a firm, competitive firm, price equals marginal cost, P equal to MR equal to MC. Now for a monopoly firm, price exceeds the marginal cost, or P is greater than MC equal to MC. So monopoly's profit is profit equals to total revenue minus total cost. This is the profit. These are same thing basically, total revenue by total cost, and it's nothing but this is the average cost, and this is the average revenue, this is the average cost. So average revenue minus average cost into Q also will give you the profit, or price minus average total cost into Q also will give you the profit. They're one and the same. So here we were earlier, we're talking about the equilibrium condition. This is the marginal revenue curve, this is the demand curve, this is the average cost curve, and marginal cost curve is intersecting average revenue curve, marginal revenue curve at this point. This is the average total cost which is introduced in this diagram. Now at this point, the equilibrium price, as you have discussed, is this. At Q max, we have the equilibrium price is Q max to B. And then you can see, you may see is the cost at that point. So BC would be per unit profit. Now we multiply this with the Q or O Q max, then we'll get this entire area. The average cost is here, D. So monopoly price is here. So this entire area is the monopoly profit, because at this point of output, you can see the average cost is C, Q max C, and then what is the total cost? Q max C into O Q max, that is D O Q max C. This area is the total cost. What is the revenue? This is price. B Q max is the price. And if you multiply B Q max with O Q max, then you will get this monopoly price, that is point E here, E B Q max O is the total revenue, because P into Q, this P into Q, sorry, this P into Q will give you the revenue. So this is the total revenue. So total revenue minus total cost is this area, shaded area, which is your monopoly profit. The monopolist profit is will risk, the monopolist will receive economic profit as long as price is greater than the average total cost. Now what happens is, this monopoly profit, because monopoly itself is the industry, both in the short run and long run, it has the potential to get economic profit, because there is no entry. Earlier, if you see the perfect competitions, when there was profit, firms are entering and taking away the profit. But in monopoly, since there is no entry of other firms, both in the short run as well as in the long run, it can enjoy the profit. So the short run analysis and long run analysis for monopoly would be, in terms of profit, will not vary much. The monopolist profit, the monopolist will receive economic profit as long as the price is greater than the average total cost. Now, for example, take the example of a market for drugs. A vaccination support is discovered for corona. So what will happen here? If the monopolist price is likely to be monopoly quantity, monopolist will produce this much quantity and will sell at this price. Because he will have patented the product and he would like to earn this profit. But in the case of government, or if the price is regulated, and then efficient price would be this much. This would be the efficient price, because at that price your marginal this to average revenue is equal to price. Average revenue equal to price, and then the firm should produce this much. After the patent is over, everybody will enter, and then the price will fall down to this point, the competitive quantity price, because AR equal to price in the competitive market. Average revenue would be equal to price, or demand curve is nothing but the average revenue curve. So this would be the price after the patent expires, or if the price is at par with the competitive market price. Will fair cost of monopoly? In contrast to a competitive firm, the monopoly charges a price which is above the marginal cost. So there involves certain kind of welfare cost. From the standpoint of consumer, this high price makes monopoly undesirable. A consumer doesn't want to pay more price. Therefore, a monopoly price is always undesirable for a customer or consumer. However, from the standpoint of owners of the firm, the high price makes monopoly very desirable, because they would like, because they are earning profit. Now there is certain kind of a welfare loss in the monopoly. Monopoly sets the price above the marginal cost. It places wage between the consumer's willingness to pay and the producer's cost. This causes the quantity sold to fall short of the social optimum. Now, what happens here? Inefficiency. This is what, again, we'll come back to our own old monopoly equilibrium. This is what is the monopoly price, MC equal to MR here, and it is extended up to average revenue or the demand curve, and correspondingly this price is set. Now, if you look at marginal cost, which is the supply curve of the firm, and then the average revenue curve, sorry, this is not the supply curve. Monopoly does not have a supply curve. This point is the supply curve of the firm, and this is the demand curve. This is the efficient quantity that is being produced. So now this triangle is a kind of a welfare loss. This triangle, which is known as the deadweight loss or the welfare loss to the society. This is basically the loss to the society because of the monopoly pricing. So in inefficiency, the monopoly's output is less than socially optimal quantity of output. What is socially optimal or efficient output? This is efficient quantity of output. Had the price been this, there would not have been any welfare loss if the price would have been at the equilibrium of intersection between at this marginal cost and the demand curve. If the price would have been corresponding to this point, there would not have been any efficiency loss or the welfare loss. But since the price is above the marginal cost, the monopoly firm is having certain kind of welfare loss. Price discrimination now. At this point, any doubt is there? Just give me a minute. Is there any doubt in monopoly? Then we'll switch over to the perfectly competitive market. Price is given, so there is no pricing strategy. In monopoly, you have your market will decide, you will be having the some freedom to decide price, but there is no competition, so it also comes directly by your demand and supply conditions are so. But now on, we'll see the market structures where the managerial decisions in terms of taking prices should be there. Price discrimination. Look at price discrimination. What is price discrimination? Price discrimination is the practice of selling the same goods at different prices to different consumers, even though the cost of producing for the two customers are the same. So the firm finds out some way to charge different price to different customers. Now, what is this? The price discrimination is not possible when good is sold in a competitive market, since there are many firms all selling at the market price. In the perfectly competitive market structure, it is not possible to discriminate, because the moment you charge more price, the buyers will switch over to someone else which is selling at a lesser price. But in order to discriminate price, the firm must have certain kind of market power. You should have certain kind of market power. So you can, therefore you will be able to discriminate. But market power is not only adequate. A discriminating monopolist will have to divide his total market into different sub-markets. So when you are a discriminating monopolist, you need to divide your market into different groups of markets so that resale or transfer of demands are not possible. So in order to make price discrimination successful, there are two things. Your reselling should not be possible, and price discrimination to be successful and profitable, the elasticity of demand in different markets must be different. Conditions are like this. From firm should charge a higher price in the market where elasticity of demand is relatively less. So if you have two markets, you compute the elasticity of demand in both the market, C, and then wherever the elasticity of demand is higher, a high elasticity of demand, less should be the price. Low elasticity of demand, higher should be the price. Higher price in market where elasticity of demand is less, and lesser price in the market where elasticity of demand is more. Price elasticity of demand here. Perfect price discrimination. Now we have got different degree of price discrimination. One is perfect price discrimination, which refers to a situation when the monopolist knows exactly the willingness to pay of each customer and then charge each customer a different price. Now, this is quite interesting and difficult, because in reality, you cannot imagine a situation where the person knows exactly what is your willingness to pay. The seller knows exactly what is the willingness to pay. But I would like to give an example. Maybe consider a village doctor who knows the economic condition of each and every village inmate. So now he would be in a position to charge different. He knows the paying capacity of each and every villager. He would be able to charge different price, because in this case the service of the doctor cannot be sold, because what medicine he is prescribing to patient one, he cannot, the same may not work for the patient two, and he knows exactly the condition of the economic condition of patient one as well as patient two. Now if he charges different price, there is no other way but the people would be able to, he can probably close to someone who can discriminate the price perfectly. And in this case of perfect price discrimination, there is no consumer surplus left out. Now coming to the price discrimination, there are two important effects of price discrimination. It increases the monopolist profit and it can reduce the deadweight loss. Now, if you In the case of perfect competition, there is no deadweight loss. Similarly, harsh degree price discrimination also is a case where there is no welfare loss or no deadweight loss. But except that, other discriminating monopolies, though they reduce the deadweight loss, but there is some degree of, there will be some degree of deadweight or welfare loss, because you are not able to perfectly discriminate the price in other second or third degree price discriminations. Now, if you look at movie ticket, where price discrimination is there, or airline prices, discounted coupon, financial aids, and quantity discounts, all are examples of price discrimination. Now, if you go to the movie theater, what happens? The price differs by time. Sometimes the movie tickets on Sunday may be charged higher peak time price than Wednesday. Wednesday prices are lower in comparison to Sunday prices. Then there is, because Wednesday you are not likely to have more customers, so to attract customers you can charge lesser price on Wednesday and higher price on Sunday, because Sunday is a holiday and everybody would be interested to go for the movie. So there could be price discriminations in the case of movie tickets. Similarly, airline prices, it cannot be resale. If you want to go on behalf of you, somebody else going will not work. Therefore, there could be price discrimination. Or even our railway tickets, there is price discrimination in railway tickets. You would have observed, for example, senior citizens pay different price. The government employee may pay different price, defense people may pay different price. So when you can segregate the market and the products are not sellable, resellable, then you can charge price, you can then have price discrimination. Similarly, discount coupons, all these cases, quantity discounts, suppose you are first time you purchase in the beginning, what is that they say, the early bird offers. Suppose you are purchasing in bulk quantity or you are purchasing fast, there is some discount in price. So there, these are the way the price discrimination can take place. Now, prevalence of monopoly, you can see the monopolies are common. Most firms have some control over their price because of differentiated products. So firms with substantial monopoly powers are rare. Few goods are truly unique. Now, first degree price discrimination, the sellers is able to charge different price for different units from the same consumer. The monopolist is able to charge different price for different range of products in the second degree. That means in the first degree you are charging different price to able to charge different price for different units for same consumer. And monopolist is able to charge different price for different range or group of outputs. We have some examples here. Different range of output means, suppose you look at electricity. First 100 units is charged differently, then 100 to 200 or 250 units, then 250 units to 500 units, above 500 units. The charges per unit of electricity consumption vary. This is kind of second degree price discrimination. Similarly, if you look at railway, for example, the distance, if you travel less distance, the price per kilometer would be very high. But if you travel long distance, then the price per kilometer would be lesser. So this is what is basically second degree price discriminations, where different range or group of output are charged differently. Similarly, you have this price discriminations. For example, electricity department charges different price for different category of customers. Like you have the partitions of markets into two or more groups and charge different price to different groups. This, as I have told, is successful only when reselling is not possible. And there is difference in elasticity of demand. Now, if you look at electricity services again, what has happened? The charge that is there in the rural area differs from the urban area because markets are again separated. The rural, the unit charge of electricity consumption is lesser in comparison to the urban area. Now, within urban area, they have classified different types of customers. For example, we have residential customers, we have commercial users, we have official users, we have industrial users, and they are charged differently per unit. So, this is a kind of segregating into different markets and charging different price for them. So this is third degree price discrimination. This, with this, we have completed the monopoly. Then we'll switch over to monopolistic competition. If there's any questions at this stage on monopoly, shall we go to monopolistic? Monopolistic competition. Having understood the perfect competitions and monopoly, the monopolistic competition is basically a combination of the features of perfectly competitive market structure and the monopoly market structure. It has some monopoly element and many features of the perfect competition. Exactly how it differs from a perfectly competitive market structure is, it has also large number of buyers and sellers. It has also very, large number of buyers and sellers. Each firm has got very small shares in the market so that they cannot influence the market price, but the product is not identical. In the case of a perfectly competitive market, the products are identical, but in monopolistic competitions, there is differentiated product. And because of this product differentiation, each firm will have some degree of monopoly. Product of each firm is not a perfect substitute for the competitive firm. Like in the perfectly competitive market, we have seen the products are identical, but in monopolistic competitions, the products are not identical, they are differentiated. For example, if you go to the market and purchase certain soap or toothpaste, there are different brands. They may be substitute, close substitutes, but they are not identical in the eyes of the customers. You may prefer certain taste. You will find many reasons to prefer a particular product over something else. Therefore, they are differentiated product. The product is different from any other product. A product group represents several closely related but not identical products. Here we are talking about the term of product groups, which are closely related products. They can be substituted, but they are not identical. But that has the same general purpose for the consumer. For example, if you look at toothpaste brand 1, brand 2, Promig or Colgate or any other brand may serve the same purpose, but we have certain preference on some branded or some brand of the commodity over other for some reason or other. Maybe we like the taste, or we like the color, or we got influenced by the person who is advertising the product, or things like that. The sellers in each product group can be considered competing firms within the industry. So all the sellers within the product group who are dealing with all these differentiated or substitute, close substitute product, they are competing within the industry. The firm in the market do not consider the reaction of their rivalers firms choosing their product price or annual sales target. Now, what is this? Now, in the case of a oligopoly market, we will see, because the number of firms are very small, you will always be developing your strategy in line with the strategy developed by your competitors. But in the case of monopoly, a monopolistic market, what will happen is, because there are large number of firms and each have very small shares in the market, we do not consider the rival or the rival firm or competing firms' decisions into our own decision-making process. We take independently. The relative freedom of entry and exit of the firm, exit of firms exist in the monopolistically competitive market. So firms can freely enter or exit in the long run. In the short run, they can shut down if they are not making profit. Neither the opportunity nor the incentive exist in the for the firm in the market to cooperate in a way that decreases competition. So in the case of a oligopoly firm, you will see then there is an incentive for an oligopolist where there are very few numbers of sellers, 2, 3, or 4, and large number of buyers. There is a incentives to join hands together in deciding price and determining quantity, like for OPEC, etc. But in monopolistic market, such scope does not exist because number of firms are very large and you will not be able to do that effectively. So equilibrium of a single firm may be regarded as a monopolist. Its equilibrium condition can therefore be determined by the same way as the case of a monopolist. Its average revenue, same as the demand curve, is downward sloping, and the MR curve lies below the AR curve. We have seen in the case of monopoly, the firm will be in the equilibrium where MR equal to MC to maximize the profit. So if we have the demand curve and the marginal revenue curve, and we have seen the earlier diagram, similar diagram this is. But one thing here you will be noticing that the demand curve and marginal revenue curve of a monopolistic firm would be more flatter in comparison to the monopoly firm. Why this is flatter? Because this is more price elastic, because you have in the monopoly you are not having any kind of substitute, but here competitors are there. So in the case of perfectly competitive market, the demand curve or AR curve was a straight line, but in monopoly you will find steeper demand curve. But in monopolistic competition, the demand curve would be more flatter, though not horizontal. It would be flatter in comparison to monopoly because of the existence of the substitute products. So means if you are increasing the price, people will substitute because they have substitutes available to switch over. So therefore, the price elasticity of demand in the case of a monopolistic market structure would be higher in comparison to monopoly. Now here in this context, we talk about group equilibrium. The quality of MR and MC is not the sufficient conditions for profit. The equality of MC and MR is not the sufficient condition for profit optimization, though it is the necessary condition. Industry equilibrium is possible only when the firms is earning, all firms are, when each firm is earning normal profits or all the firms are earning normal profit. Now, in the case of monopoly, even if the firm was earning super normal profit, long run equilibrium was possible. But in the case of monopolistic competitions, because there is entry and exit, all the firms will earn normal profit in the long run, the point where AR equal to AC for each of the firms. Now, this is possible in the short run, there is super normal profit here, but in the long run, new firms will enter that will increase, that will shift the demand curve upward and ensure downward. Because of more number of entry, your demand curve and marginal revenue curve will shift downward and ensure that your AC is tangential to the demand curve at this point, and you will get an equilibrium here. So basically what happens in the monopolistic competitions, the both loss and profits are possible only in the short run, but in the long run what will happen is, because of the entry and exit conditions, like in the case of your perfect competitions, all the firms will earn only normal profit, and there is no scope for super normal or extra normal profit. So this will be the long run equilibrium of the firm. Now here we can see, if the firm is earning, the price is here, the price is somewhere, price is set at P1 in a monopolistic firm, that is, he is producing OQ1 output, he has equated MC with MR and producing output which is Q1 and earning a normal profit here. But had it been a perfectly competitive market, the price would have been equal to your, the output would have been somewhere here at the minimum point of LMC, LMC equal to AC. This would have been the price. So this is what is efficient output or the excess capacity. Q1, Q2 is the excess capacity which would have been produced under perfect competition. The monopolist can produce up to this. Monopolistic competitions can produce output up to this. Now, advertising, product development in the monopolistic market competition. The product differentiation is the hallmark of a monopolistically competitive market. And therefore, we'll see the products are advertised aggressively, and they demonstrate how their product is different from others so that they can capture the market share. So advertising and product development, that is, that you will be able to see in the case of a monopolistic competitive market. In many cases, firm incur cost either to make the unique characteristics of their products known to the customers, or to convince the consumer that their products really is different from those of their rivals. So if you can create an impression among the customers that your product is actually different, then you will be able to attract the students, you will be able to attract the customers to buy your product. The total cost is the selling cost plus the advertisement cost. Here the average cost is also the advertisement cost plus selling cost divided by the total output. So this is what is about your monopolistic market structure. Generally what happens, the student gets confused in exam between monopoly and monopolistic. Please remember, there is a difference between monopoly market and monopolistic market. If the question comes one, they at times have written the other one. And though the answer for monopoly is completely right, if the question is on monopolistic, we can't help. So what happens is, monopoly, there is only a single seller, but in the case of monopolistic, there is large number of sellers and the products are differentiated. Now, coming to oligopoly, we'll have very short time now to finish. Only a few firms supply the entire market with a product that may be standardized or differentiated. At least some firms have large market share and thus can influence the price of the product. So in the oligopoly market, what is happening? Only few firms. Now, if you see perfect competitions, large number of firms. Monopoly, single firm. Monopolistic competitions, again, large number of firms dealing with differentiated or homogeneous product. But in the case of the oligopoly market, only few firms exist and they supply the entire market with a product that may be either standardized or homogeneous or a differentiated product. Now, at least some firms have large market share. In the For example, we have top four companies or top two, three companies will have 70% or 80% market share. So unlike the perfectly competitive or monopolistic market structure, their individual action has impact on market outcome. In an oligopoly market structure, the individual action of the firm has certain influence on the market outcome. The standalone can change the price by altering the quantity, or they can affect the market outcomes. They can change the price and the quantity they supply, and it will have impact on the market outcomes. The firms in the oligopolistic industry are aware of the interdependence. That means if you are seeing monopoly, need not have to bother about the competitor because there is no competitor. In a perfectly market, competitive market, there are large number of firms. Each of them are just like one drop in the ocean. So they cannot do standalone anything. So they at least bother about other competitors. In a monopolistic market structure, similarly, there are large number of firms. So who is doing what is not known to each other. They are working independently. But in oligopoly market, since there are only two or three, it is possible to, and it is also profitable, or you can take decisions, or you cannot ignore the decision of your rival firm. The concept of competitions, rivalriness, etc., comes really in the context of a oligopolistic market structure where only two or three competitors are there who have got large market share. So what they are doing alters your outcome. So the firm in the oligopolistic industry are aware of their interdependence. That means they are interdependent between each other. Yes.
Presentation ka out gote lanna share kole nijo screen se pai ame dekhi parnu
athare koribi share
ha auto kore apdu se
koti gala go to kotila seta
learners if you have any screen apan present korte se
bora screen last presentation ta nai sir
last
oligopoly ro sir next start thi ki last
Next, sir.
हाँ सर बस
हाँ सो दिस इज बेसिकली द फर्म्स इन द ओलिगोपोलिस्टिक इंडस्ट्री आर अवेयर ऑफ देयर इंटरडिपेंडेंस एंड ऑलवेज कंसीडर देयर राइवल्स रिएक्शंस व्हेन सेटलिंग प्राइस आउटपुट गोल्स एडवर्टाइजिंग बजेट्स एंड अदर बिजनेस पॉलिसी. So the decision that you are taking, the business decisions, if you look at all these concepts that I have discussed here, the advertising budget, how much you should spend on advertisement, or how much output you should produce as a firm, you cannot stand alone decide. Somewhere or other, your rivals or your competitors' decision, what they are doing, if they are increasing their expenditure on budget, you tend to increase your budget expenditure. Actually, in an oligopoly, this is also a kind of a business dilemma, we say. So, suppose in an oligopoly market structure, they discuss together, which is not legal, that it will see, cartel is not legal, but if they decide together and do not advertise at all, they will save a lot of money. But just to attract markets there, what they do, they get into competitive advertising or aggressive advertisement. One person is advertising, the other will increase because they are interdependent. If one is doing something, the other will have to follow or have a different strategy. Suppose one is increasing the output, you tend to increase. So your decision is not independent. You are always, your decisions or business decisions are always is dependent on the business decision that is taken by the competitors. So the, your business policies are affected by the business policies or practices that is adopted by your competitors or the rivalry firm in the case of oligopoly. The indeterminateness of demand curve is facing in the oligopolistic firm. So you will have non-collusive oligopoly. This is a situation where the firms are assumed never to learn from the past experience, which makes their behavior at least immature or naive. What happens if one firm is increasing advertisement, you tend to increase, then again the second firm will increase, then again you will increase, and you tend to spend lot of money in the advertisement without learning from each other, because you are not collusive, you are not consulting each other, you are not allowed to do that also, and then in the process you are acting as an immature person and losing business opportunities or profits, because without spending too much money also on advertisement you would be able to earn better profit, but you are not getting into that because you are following or reacting to the business decision of your competitor. Then and there is a case of the collusive oligopoly. One of the main features of an oligopolistic market is uncertainty arising from oligopolistic interdependence. To avoid this uncertainty, the oligopolist may enter into collusive agreement. There are two types of, theoretically there are two types of collusion, cartel and price leadership. Now, cartels are not allowed within a country. Generally, it is considered to be illegal. However, if you see OPEC, this petroleum producing nations, Saudi Arabia, etc., they form a cartel of OPEC and then they jointly decide the price. Internationally, cartels are being formed. So cartel implies direct agreement among competing oligopolists. So with the aim of reducing uncertainty. Now, what happens in the case of a cartel? Now they will decide, they will fix how much output to be produced and what price they will sell. And then accordingly they will divide the market and then they will act. So if they come join hands together and then decides in what would be the share of each of the member of the cartel and what price they should be selling, the uncertainty from the supplier's point of view will drastically reduce. Otherwise, in the absence of such cartels, what will happen? They will compete, they will end up selling at a price which is lesser than what they should have told, they should have sold in the absence of a cartel. So this is what is basically the cartel. We'll examine two typical forms of cartel. Cartel among a joint profit maximization, that is maximization of industry profit, and cartel aiming at the sharing of the market. So cartel aiming at joint profit maximization or market sharing cartels are there. In this particular case, the aim of the cartel is the maximization of industry's joint profit. Now OPEC as a whole would see how the profit of the entire OPEC is maximized, and then they can decide who should get how much share. We concentrate on a homogeneous or pure oligopoly, that is an oligopoly where all farm producers are homogeneous. The petroleum products are basically homogeneous. Okay, so we can decide like that. The central agency, in this case, the cartel they form, there may be a central agency which will have access to the cost figures of the individual firms, and for the purpose of the present context, we unrealistically assume that it will be calculated, it will calculate the market demand curve and the corresponding market revenue curve. If it is able to calculate from the horizontal summation of the MC curve of the firm, individual firms, the market MC curves can be derived. like what we have done in the case of perfect competitions or other market structure. And the central agency will set the price defined by the intersections of MR curve of the industry and the MC curve. So similarly, that price would be uniform for all the firm, and they would be selling at that market determined price. Now, market sharing cartel, what is this? The firm agree to share the market but keep the considerable degree of freedom concerning the style of their output, their selling activities, and other decisions. They will share the market. There are two basic methods for sharing the market and determination of quota. So non-price determination of quota means they can decide how much in how much quantity to be sold by each of them. And there is non-price competition agreement. They will have an agreement that we will not compete in terms of price, because this is disadvantage to each member of the cartel. But cartel formation, please remember, within the nation, within one nation, is illegal, because they may be against the consumer's interest. So thank you. With this, we have completed the oligopoly also. Taken little more time because topics are more. Now you can ask if there is some questions. Still visible to which is the okay. Yes.
Thank you very much, sir. Hello. Thank you very much, sir, for such a nice and wonderful presentation. Now I request our learners, if any doubt, please you may ask your questions or queries in the chat box. Today, this session was wonderful. The session was wonderful because our resource person has explained each and every concepts relating to pricing decision, starting from the term market to the term oligopoly, non-collusive oligopoly, and cartels, everything. He is also explained about the various features of different market forms, and also explaining the different market conditions for profit maximization. So I think our learners, there is no more questions from the side of our learners.
If they have, so, I can still take a few. Please feel free.
Dear learners, feel free to ask questions.
Somebody has written supply. What is that? I'm not. Is there any question on supply in between? There are some question on supply. Harshini and Harshita ji. Oh, supply go down. That was a response to my question. Okay, fine.
Okay, I think, sir, no more questions or no questions from the side of learners. So,
or we can unmute them if they're interested. If they're not able to, they're not interested to write, that is also fine. Otherwise, we can close. Okay, close the session then. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, once again. And with this, we wind up.